Well, welcome, everyone. Welcome to the next in the series of St. John's Doctor's Talk. And we're really pleased to have as a return visitor, Dr. Matthew Godlewski. Dr. Godlewski, as you know, is a real expert in burn rehabilitation. There aren't very many across North America. I think the last time I said there were 10, and you corrected me and said, no, it's really only about five, at least five who are academically productive. So we're really pleased to have you back and turn things over to you.
I think we're actually down to four.
Oh, okay.
Cool. I don't think Peter's seeing patients anymore.
So you're 25%.
Yeah, exactly. Well, thank you for having me. For today's talk, last year when I did this, I did a bit of an overview of burn rehabilitation as a topic, some of the things that we face day to day and some basic signs. What I wanted to try to do this year is really just focus on a handful of papers that have been published in the recent past. And I've tried to select ones that maybe most important or most urgent to me is they're ones that really made me think or kind of challenge how I was thinking about things or I felt like taught me something new. And I also tried to pick ones that I thought had some, maybe some benefit, not just to the world of burn, but kind of thinking about our patients in a broader light. So the three that I'm going to be really focusing on, one is a recent paper actually out of Ontario, which we'll go over, looking at the psychological impact related to burn injury. Another is a paired series of articles that had the rare opportunity to look at patients almost 20 years out from the time of burn injury to get a sense of what challenges they still face even longer term. And then finally, since this reflects a bit of a relative change in practice since I began doing burn injuries, some papers looking at the use of pregabalin following burn. So starting with psychological impact, and as I mentioned, this is work that was done right here in Ontario. This paper looked at the number of mental health visits in time before and after burn injury. And what they really wanted to do is try to look at this prospectively in terms of the risk factors for access to mental health following the burn. But they did also look at the preceding period as a bit of a control and actually learn some interesting lessons from both sides of it. These are all self-matched controls. These are patients who were admitted to, I think, all to the Rosslea Burn Center, and really relied on the exceptionally strong Canadian databases in terms of accessing, you know, where patients have accessed care and what diagnoses have been coded for that. This looked at patients with major burn injury, so greater than 10% TBSA or more critical parts of their body, and it was all in adults. As I mentioned, this was really looking at coding for mental health visits, and this was not just routine care. So any of the things that we would generally do where a patient is going to see, like a psychiatrist here, going to like outpatient psychology, that is not what they were looking at. They were really capturing things in more emergency databases where patients were presenting for emergency medical health, or mental health, excuse me, or going to an emergency department. And they were specifically looking at certain codes around things like self-harm, substance abuse, schizophrenia, and others. The other thing about this is that they did span 3 years before and after the burn injury. So the numbers are pretty strong. They were able to capture 1,500 patients that had come through this system. And for a study like this, to me, that's actually a fairly robust number. Not surprisingly for the burn population, most of these patients were men, also kind of probably relative to the different areas in Ontario. Most were urban, and the majority were from lower income areas. Just to give a sense of perspective, so the relative burn size was 15 TBSA, and because this will be important later on, only about 3% of these cases were cases of self-harm, where somebody had inflicted the burn injury upon themselves. Now, overall, looking at like how many times somebody was accessing care in the 3 years before injury and then the 3 years after, mental health visits were about the same, 10% versus 12%. So from that perspective, nothing too exciting. But when they really looked at it, they decided to look at this idea of low utilizers versus high utilizers. So what did this mean to them? That the vast majority of the patients in this database had essentially not been using the mental health system, certainly not in an emergency fashion, before their burn injury. So 94% of these patients in the 3 years preceding the burn had one or less visits to mental health for any of these issues. Maybe not surprisingly, there were some other patients who were suffering much more from mental health, substance abuse, or other issues. So there was a small group, 6%, where they consider them high utilizers. These were patients who were recurrently going back to emergency departments for mental health problems. So where does this really play out? So for the low utilizers, people who were not having problems like this, at least not with any regularity before the burn injury, they found that their rate of mental health visits went up 3 times after the burn happened. And in particular, and there's a nice slide on this on the next page, but that the risk of self-harm as a presenting feature went up 4 times after a burn injury. And unfortunately, I think as at least some in this room know, Matt, this came up, what was this last week? Matt Boyle probably spent, I'm imagining, most of your afternoon in outpatient when a patient was formed because of concerns about self-harm right here from our hospital.
A big team effort as well.
Yeah, not just you.
A lot of people have supported that.
Yeah. No, you're just sitting right in front of me. I don't mean to exclude other people. The other things about this is that I'd have to tap into like Rosalie and Matt and others about kind of the relative incidence, but they actually found that the patients who are most at risk following a burn injury were women, people from higher income brackets, and those that had medical problems pre-existing before the burn injury. Again, not things that would necessarily follow to me as the patients I would think would be most at risk after having had a burn. Certainly not the highest income brackets. That would not be the first thing I would think of. Interestingly enough, for the patients who were high utilizers before, their visits went down. So even though the relative rates of going to mental health for emergencies after the burn was about the same for the whole group, for the low utilizers, it was going up, and for the high utilizers, it actually went down a little bit following the burn. And this is a bit... this is kind of a slide summarizing that. What you can see on the low utilizer, so again, patients who had only presented maybe once in the last 3 years or less, you can see that the numbers are a pretty big jump, that in the rate of things like presentations, particularly if you look at self-harm, this rate of 0.7 for person years, jumping up to 12, that all of this column is looking a fair bit more solid than before the injury. You can see that in the high utilizers, again, this is like the rate of utilization was much, much higher. You can see that these numbers are much bigger than that for the low utilizers. Numbers about the same. They did not do any speculation because of the nature of this study about why this might be. I do wonder if that these are patients who, if they had been kind of flitting in and out of the mental health care system, if after having a burn injury, they actually got some dedicated time with, say, mental health and access, that maybe actually had a bit of a preventative effect after, but there's no way to say that from this study. The thing I actually was most struck by, like, so again, I think there's some really good learning opportunities here about what to look for moving forward, but was that they looked at this period of 3 years before the burn injury. And my first thought would be like, yeah, so there's just going to be some level of risk, but that it's a static thing. What they found, though, is that before the burn injury for the first 2 years, so like minus 3 years, minus 2 years, that the number of visits people had were the same. But then they started to steadily increase in the year before the burn injury. This is before the burn injury ever happened. And that the greatest number of visits were actually happening in the 12 weeks before the burn. So you can see actually when they put this on a graph, it's actually, I think, pretty jarring that, you know, if this dotted line is when the burn injury happened, you can see that these self-harm visits, these mental health visits, that there's this big uptick that's leading into the time before the burn injury. This really kind of shook me because I know, you know, there are patients out there who are really struggling with substance abuse, with longstanding mental health issues. But I guess I always thought of these things as having a fairly stable risk from year to year. It never really crossed my mind that maybe somebody was moving into a period of crisis right before the burn injury. Maybe more importantly, was there something that could have been done differently during that time period to stop the burn from ever happening in the first place? So again, this kind of like looked to me like, well, what does it mean for somebody to be at risk? Like to me, I always thought it was something more like, you know, stable from year to year, but this is saying that's probably not the correct. And then also looking at some of these risk factors for who is most at risk for self-harm things or other mental health visits afterwards. So like people even in higher income brackets, women more than men. And I as far as I know, not that I read this literature all that often, I don't know that these studies have been done in trauma. But it wouldn't shock me if similar patterns exist for all trauma populations, not just for burn injury. The next one, this is a fairly dry article. Go ahead. Yeah.
Does this pattern reflect how other trauma situations also reflects
yeah, kind of the concept of like a sentinel set of events that would be a warning sign that in hindsight you would know that you should have done something different.
There is some data around some of the presentations before suicide attempts or self-harm behaviors, and oftentimes people will present. The majority of those cases are never seen by psychiatrists as well, too. So that was some of the data that's come through from looking at the Sunnybrook side of things. And it's interesting, this data sort of aligns too with the general psychiatry population. So seeing that women are more at risk for self-harm after burn is similar to the rest of the field too. So when you look at the data, women are four times more likely to be at risk for a risk for suicide attempts. Men are four times more likely to complete suicide. So oftentimes women will do less lethal means of self-harm, like overdose or other things. Men tend to do more violent things like gunshots or hanging or other things. So the data around that is fairly similar to what we see in around serving in general population around suicide as well too, that women are more likely to attempt suicide, but men are more likely to complete suicide.
Gotcha. Thank you.
The self-harm, that was the 6%, I think you said, or 3%. That was the overt self-harm. Does this say that many of the other burns were a result of mental illness as well, not just the overt self-harm ones?
Yeah, the I can't speak to numbers, but I think it's I think there's a fair bit of data in the burn literature that, you know, people who, for a variety of reasons, between significant mental health issues, like struggles with substance abuse, inherently tend to be also taking at-risk behaviors or in situations where burn injury, trauma, other problems would tend to be more common. So as we're getting into, so this these set of papers, again, this is, it may be a little bit dry, but long-term outcome studies, to my mind, are extremely rare, and to have the opportunity to look at some of the things patients are experiencing, even decades after an injury, to me is just a valuable idea. What this was is that patients going to a major burn center and also going to a World Burn Congress, so like an annual meeting of survivors, were asked to do a number of evaluations, things like surveys and physical examinations. These patients were adults, larger burns, so 30% TBSA or greater is who they were screening for, and more than 3 years after their burn injury. One thing that's kind of striking about this is that, and may potentially kind of color the results as well, is that these were not small burn injuries. So of the patients that they gathered, a fair number, so between these two sources, the Burn Center and the World Burn Congress, roughly about 100 people who were far out from the time of their burn injury, you can see that the TBSA is greater than 50%. So these are major burn injuries, fairly catastrophic events. And also, as I was alluding to, the average amount of time from the time injury is 17 years. So these are really patients who have like a perspective on what's happened to them. Interestingly, you know, some of the things that are the most common complaints are the things that maybe we think about sometimes maybe the least in the hospitalized setting. You know, that some of these things about how the skin has changed permanently, physiologically, the things that are lost in that dermal layer, things like oil glands, sweat glands, things like that. Again, these don't really impact too much of what we do in the first, say, month or two, maybe not even the first 6 months. But for patients longer term, so 17 years out, problems with heat tolerance, 3/4 of patients, problems with still having itching from probably lack of skin moisturization, 70%, needing to still put on lotion, 80% of patients. So again, just to kind of give some perspective on these are the things that, you know, 20 years basically out, patients are still saying are bothering them in a significant way. And certainly a number of other things here, you know, not uncommon. They also looked at kind of patients' perspective of their skin. These are kind of, they have them broken down between Caucasian, African-American, Hispanic. And there are some, mostly it's overall about the same, that patients are still having like reasonable problems with like changes in pigmentation in their skin, although depending on the grouping, either hypo or hyperpigmentation, lighter or darker, bother them in different ways. Hypertrophic scarring pretty much throughout, so excessive scar formation still bothering them 17 years later, and particularly in the group of African-American patients, you know, 100% that patients were still being bothered by that. And again, just kind of giving an idea, like this is just a bit of a snapshot of what patients are experiencing long-term. They also looked at a number of musculoskeletal things, so many of the patients were still having problems with joint pain, joint stiffness, and problems with like more athletic type activities. And when they also looked at this in terms of health-related quality of life, some things around different measures of like people's perceived ability physically and so forth, a lot of these ended up being a bit correlated with how much they felt like they still had joint problems even 20 years later. And this really, again, doubles back to a lot of the efforts we begin, you know, day zero after a burn injury, but certainly that a lot of the people in this room work on, you know, preventing contracture, trying to get range of motion back. I partly bring this up too to say this makes a difference, that you know, that this is why we work on it, because these are things that if they last, they're going to bother patients for decades. A bit of a busy slide, but I'll mostly just focus on this one loss of motion. You can just see that the majority of patients across all categories, like regardless of how far they are, in a sense, like the majority of patients are still having problems with range of motions even 20 years later. I guess what I'd also say in this, like to me, this is also kind of, it throws a challenge out to us, like we're now like practicing today, is that these are the outcomes of patients treated largely like in the 90s. So, I mean, again, my hope would be as we're continuing to move things forward, that we can make this better for the future generations of patients who are burn survivors. And maybe, again, it just kind of highlights the importance of doing so. They also looked a bit at return to work, that for patients who, about two-thirds of the patients were employed when the burn happened, about another quarter had been in school. Most were able to go back to work. However, only about half were able to go back to the job that they had. The other ones had to do some other alternate type of employment. Likewise, about half of patients were able to return to school. Obviously, wish that number were better. I do also wonder if that one has more issues around kind of like social and body image issues, particularly for that age group. Again, I already mentioned I present this partly just to sort of give us like a bit of perspective about these longer term things for what we do here today, but also as a way of us kind of teaching our patients some of the things to expect. The only good thing about this, I suppose, is that compared to, you know, if things like pruritus are the number one complaint, well, at least that's what it is. It's not, I can't walk, I can't, you know, I never got back to doing other things. Like, so they are things that can be manageable, but again, but they are still impacting people's lives. The last thing to go over is pregabalin, because it's really taken a bit of a rise in the burn community in the last 5 years. And just for background, burn pain is often considered in three different ways. This idea of background pain, pain that's there 24 hours a day. This is mostly described when patients are in the intensive care unit, to some degree when they're in our phase of care. Procedural pain, so things like dressing changes and therapy. And finally, these ideas of neuropathic pain, where patients from, you know, something related to the nervous system are having these more like burning, tingling type symptoms. And these can be particularly important in burn injury because, you know, if you're deep enough of a burn to need skin grafting, you're deep enough that you've damaged all of your nerve endings that are living in the dermis. The two things are synonymous. One concept that I've not read about much yet, but just as an interesting idea, is because people have lost all of this and the graft does not replace it, there's even this newer concept that maybe there's something akin to phantom limb pain, that there's actually something phantom skin pain. Again, I haven't really seen this written about yet, but it's just kind of a curious idea that, yeah, you do have a permanent loss of organ. It just happens to be a very thin one and a very widespread one, and maybe there's actually consequences for that, similar to what we think of in phantom pain. So pregabalin, I have, as an maybe because I'm an American, I have particular ideas about the origins of pregabalin, which I'll share in a sec. But at its base, it was initially designed, it's still considered as an anticonvulsant in many ways, although I don't think it really has a whole lot of role there. And it's largely taken on this role in analgesic management. How it works isn't entirely clear, but it probably has to do with the fact probably that it has some relationship to the size and shape of GABA, an inhibitory neurotransmitter. Side effects, I think, as most of us know, tend to be fairly mild, but they do exist, things like dizziness and somnolence. It's renally cleared, and maybe most important, especially for recent updates in Ontario in the last year, it's not an opiate. My own two cents on this is that gabapentin, I think, came out in the late 80s, early 90s, and was initially billed, if I recall, as an anticonvulsant. It does not do that particularly well, and I think the drug company actually got in trouble for marketing it that way because they didn't really have the literature to back that. And then what happened is people started to discover it maybe has this role in pain, and so they basically just rebranded it with some smaller changes to be able to capture the fact that they could now have a new, fresh patent and make money again. I do think it's a good drug, but it has a bit of a storied history. So for this study looking at their role of pregabalin, they looked at a number of patients, adults with even relatively small burn injuries, 5%, and they were looking specifically at neuropathic pain scales, which I'll go into in a sec. Not surprisingly, these are pretty basic, but excluded patients with liver or kidney disease, or those that had a major contraindication, allergies, already on drugs for seizure disorders, pregnancy, things like that, or things like pre-existing pain or mental health issues that might color the data. This is the major scale they use. It's basically a 1 to 10 scale looking at different aspects of neuropathic pain. They were mostly looking at some of the ones like sharp and hot, which I'll get into, but it's basically this 1 to 10 scale. What they did is they randomized people to either be on the drug or a placebo, and if their pain wasn't under good control, they would keep on increasing the doses of both. So they would get more placebo pills or they would get more pregabalin pills. And they could still get all the usual things, things like morphine and other drugs to get them through their wound care. They looked at a number of things based on this neuropathic pain scale, how they were doing with their procedural pain, how many opiates they were using, and any side effects. And again, they were mostly focusing on sharp pain and hot pain as the things they were hoping to reduce by using pregabalin. Pretty decent number, at least for like a drug trial and burn, that they had about 30-odd patients in both arms. This happened over 4 weeks immediately after the time of burn injury. They did get up to pretty good-sized doses. So for those who don't know, 520 milligrams of pregabalin a day is pretty much cresting on the maximum dose. And then there are side effects in both groups, but they were about the same. So even the people who had placebos complained of similar things. But there were a couple of patients that had a small rise in their liver function tests and had to be stopped on the pregabalin. So just to go through some of the results, looking at their two major outcomes, you can see there is some, the black line being their pain scores on pregabalin, the gray line being on the placebo. You can see that they did find some statistical difference between the two, but you can see in terms of clinical difference, we're looking at fairly small things, that it's like less than half of a point difference in terms of what they complained of. Small but important is how many morphine equivalents patients were taking. Again, this is not a huge change between the two lines, but as we're all knowing with some of the dangers of opiates and how long we use them, I would say any benefit we're getting where we're dropping someone's opiate use is fine by me. This is the thing that's actually really changed management over the last couple of years is that they also looked at some of the other scales and they looked at the one for itching. So like I kind of led with in all this, itching is a bad thing for burn patients. Again, we were just looking at 17 years later. That's one of the major complaints they have is they still have itchiness in their skin. So what they found with all comers was that by putting patients on pregabalin, they were dropping their reports of itching by a whole point. When they looked at the bigger burn injuries, this starts to look like more like something we should really be using, where you can see this is the line of patients, how much itching they were having off pregabalin, and this is how they did when they're on pregabalin.
And add one more thing about pregabalin is psychiatry loves pregabalin because it was recently added as a first-line intervention for anxiety disorders. And so if we can kill two birds with one stone, then we can maximize the benefits.
Well, maybe three if we're doing pain, itching, and anxiety. Yeah. So if ever it comes up in rounds, people are like, should we wean the pregabalin? And I'm like, no, this might be why. Just to kind of double down on this for a more recent review, this is a bit of an odd study on how they approach it, but this is a retrospective paper looking at children and adolescents that they treated with pregabalin and gabapentin. Basically, they were looking at patients, this is now specifically for itching, because I think that was the big finding from this last study. Fairly decent number, 136 kids, who had failed trials with antihistamines, which were the go-to for many, many years. Certainly when I first started practicing burn, that's what we did for itching, was provide things like hydroxyzine or Benadryl. So these were patients that had not had their itching under control from that. And they put them on a protocol where they put them on, this is a bit odd, they put them on gabapentin, and if their itching didn't get completely better on gabapentin, they then added pregabalin on top of that. Because these are, for the most part, basically the same drug, that's a bit of an odd approach of basically doubling them down, but it's what they did. But they did find that the majority of patients just on gabapentin alone were having a significant improvement in pruritus and neuropathic pain. And for those who didn't quite get there with those two things, when they started adding pregabalin as well, the majority had their symptoms improved. So this is I have this here just to remind me. So just because it looks like a duck quacks like a duck doesn't mean it's a duck. So what I mean with this is that, like, I think for many, many years when patients with burn injury had itching, we said, well, Patient says their skin is itching. What do we do about that? We give them antihistamines. Like, that's the approach for itching. But for burn recovery, probably not a whole lot of this has to do with histamine. It's probably not an allergic response. It's inflammatory, it's swelling, it's nerve injury. It's probably a lot of other things that have nothing to do with this. Doesn't mean that antihistamines don't maybe have a role, but again, it's just kind of changing how we're approaching it. That's all I have. Lisa, I wanted to basically just give like some papers that have changed a little bit of how I'm thinking about burn, how I'm treating burn. I hope they get some perspective on long-term recovery, but mostly just wanted to open up back to questions and see if you had anything you wanted to ask.
It's been great. Thank you, Matt.
Thanks.
And perhaps you touched on this in the beginning, so I'm sorry if I missed it. But when these steps, were all the burns related to thermal injury, or were they combined, i.e. electrical,
I'm trying to think back for all three. I don't remember them mentioning much about electrical one way or the other. Generally speaking, I think electrical usually makes up about, I want to say about 2-3% of burns, so probably majority of these are thermal.
I find it really troubling to see this long-term ongoing residual pain, disability, itch. In this day and age, there's this practicing wisely approach in family practice care. We are attempting to de-prescribe medication. We're pulling away opioids. We're pulling away benzos, particularly in the onion. I don't think any of us who can paddle burn care would really think about putting GABA and Lyrica together because of somnolence and increased risk of falls. But it just worries me. I try to pull away the opioids. I leave the Lyrica or the GABA as sort of a last step. But do I want to pull that away, especially knowing that there's such a long-term impact on these ongoing symptoms? And can I practice wisely? Can I practice unwisely, but perhaps improve the patient's response to some of these lingering symptoms? It's really a tough balance.
Yeah, I think one of the things that I still feel like I'm struggling with a bit is that there, in some schools of thought, the idea of like early aggressive management can sometimes lead to patients being on too much of things. The idea that pain, in the States, was started to treat as like a vital sign that you had to take it every time. But between that and drug marketing, patients, now we have an opioid crisis. And so it's not that we should ignore patients' pain, but maybe something in that was getting misguided. On the other hand, I don't know if Amanda, if you'd be able to speak to this more, but at least with amputation populations, there's some thought around the fact that if you do really aggressive pain medication, maybe you're actually going to prevent long-term pain complications. I know that still gets debated back and forth, but it is just kind of just from a philosophy point of view, which is better and it doesn't matter which medications you're on. I'm not a big fan of marijuana at all, because what I saw in Colorado when it became legal is people were using so much of it that it was basically throwing off all their basic receptors. And so once they were off of it, their pain and anxiety would shoot through the roof. So yeah, it made them feel better today, but it was probably making them worse tomorrow. Same things we worry about with opiates. I don't know, so I didn't give you a chance to talk. Do you have anything to...
No, I think it's true, and I think a lot of times analogy doing blocks, which is very difficult to do for burns, but at least with an amputee, when you lose a limb, we can do a block with anesthesia. But burn, like you said, it's a huge organ that's probably causing pain.
Yeah.
Are you using them both together upstairs?
Both gabapentin and pregabalin. Yeah. No, this was new to me in looking this as an article. I've not been in the habit of doing that. I would usually go to a different kind of mechanism of action if I were to think of doing that.
Because we're not using them.
This idea of a phantom skin pain is really intriguing. It's the first time I've heard of that. And I was just curious, Amanda, are there things that you do in phantom limb pain that aren't part of what Matt talked about? Other treatments?
Yeah, well, we use mirror therapy a lot for patients that can cognitively try that. And we started to do some more virtual reality stuff, just mimicking the phantom limb, but also TENS and desensitization, which I think the burns team does as well.
I don't think we've ever, this was kind of a new idea to me too. I don't know, I don't see Terrence in the room, and I think I saw Ali. Do we ever use, and some others, have you ever tried using mirror therapy for a patient with a unilateral brain injury?
Yeah, your test should be. Any doctor that is available, please report to the information desk. Any doctor that is available, please report to the information desk.
So I can repeat your answer. I was getting distracted by the all doctors.
Yeah, I think you definitely have all the different groups that are using the lab, like all special coverage, that means that you could use that. But it wouldn't be like a first line of exposure. It would be someone who has more like a chronic pain or serious.
Yes. Do you feel like it helped when you did mirror therapy?
Yeah, I think maybe Terrence and some of the other OGs can speak better to that, but I think they're having success with that.
We mostly follow the freedom of imagery concept coming from Australia. Under David Butler, the research. So if you go through the hierarchy of collaterality, positive imagery, and also mirror therapy, so you're creating a neural matrix able to create a reorganization of the homeostasis. So that way, we can help to desensitize the painful area. But the process by itself is quite labor intensive and also very long. And also the client has to buy in that concept. I mean, you come to a guy to talk about you. So you don't think about your lips, you don't think about moving. So then they will say, well, I want someone to give me the pain relief right away. So that's the chance of applying these techniques. So between us and what we do is our patients for burn and trauma. We usually use other techniques, a lot of manual therapy techniques. We use a lot of our patient release the pain cycle techniques, and these are more focused on using a lot of the orthopathic techniques. So that we help them to control the pain to a certain level before we apply these relatively more abstract concepts.
I know in Montreal they're trying something that was novel to me, which is normally when I think about desensitization, I think of it in the area of injury. But they've been trying something where they're going to non-injured skin in the same like dermatome and peripheral nerve distribution and doing like manual techniques in that area. And they're actually finding that it may help with the area that was injured. So again, just kind of like out of the box ways of thinking about it. So another question?
I was just going to ask you about the pre-gap, which I said is not an opioid, right? So do people develop a tolerance to that? Like if you've been a 17-year-old and you're
happy to hear from the crowd. To the best of my knowledge, no. Has anyone, does anybody know in the medical literature that they've encountered that? I haven't seen it in practice either.
I was really struck by, from the mental health side, of the potential for intervention prior to the burn.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering where these people are presenting, if anywhere, in those 12 weeks, are they going to emerge? Is it just emerge data that they
were? Yeah, I think I can, they didn't mean much to me, so I didn't put them in the slides, but they did, there's specific databases they looked at in terms of how things were coded from certain locations, so I'd be happy to show them to you.
But even with suicide, they don't come to psychiatry, they go to emerge physicians, and emerge physicians discharge them. So I'm wondering if there's some intervention we could think of with our emerge colleagues, perhaps, to begin to be more mindful about the progression where someone actually gets to that point. I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
Well, one thing I don't think they looked at, I didn't realize that that would happen. So one thing is I think they looked at patients who presented to an emergency department with, say, a code of self-harm, or patients who reported to an emergent mental health situation with a report of self-harm. They didn't. I don't think they looked to see, did one patient group do better than the other? Like in terms of, like, did the ones who ended up actually getting mental health, like, did they have a lower risk 12 weeks later? Did they not? Were they not in that? Like, were they a different subgroup, basically?
Some patients who show up intoxicated, who really could benefit from mental health, who raise their risk for all kinds of these things, do get discharged. So I'm just, you know, thinking, you know, how can we find them, grab them, catch them, prevent this from happening?
No, I think that's, I mean, again, it's much of a rehab thing, but that to me is actually the most compelling thing about it is, like, oh, wait, there was a chance to maybe stop this from happening. Put me out of a job.
People that come with burn injuries, they have a profile, like they always have these other comorbidities that have been going on. And actually, as you said about the trauma, it's interesting, like a lot of people, especially pedestrians, they get hit by a car, are often sort of that same profile. Like, so what is it that's going on that they're not paying attention, or like what's happening? Because we sort of found that anecdotally, we're like, yeah, it's like, what's going on with these people that they end up in these dangerous situations and they get injured? So that was like proof, numerical proof that it's all mm-hmm.
I think the other thing too, I noticed just on sort of the follow up here, like the teams on the inpatient side and the outpatient side, they get wonderful sort of interdisciplinary care. I think the real gap looking at this data is sort of what happens after St. John's rehab. So when we're doing the outpatient clinic, we have OT, PT, nursing, social work, psychology, myself, yourself, Dr. Jeschke, may have up to 10 specialists involved, and they go from that. And again, we're running into this with some of our clients as well too, in terms of making transitions afterwards, because they go from having 10 healthcare providers providing sort of this wonderful care to now everything's on your family doctor to sort of take mm-hmm. over from there. So I think there's a real gap in the system for almost sort of a step down program from rehab or something along those lines for these patients that are being.
I've heard that, I think I've heard a lot of that data, like for say chemotherapy, that patients would say, like, yeah, you cured my cancer, but now, like, my life's been on hold for 6 months, I've lost 50 pounds, and I don't know where I'm supposed to go tomorrow. Nobody's checking in.
Part of it is sometimes for some of their clients, because of the psychosocial factors, we sort of become their main supports. Mm-hmm. And again, for that, sometimes if we're withdrawing all of our support, sort of what, it's not surprising we expect to see some of these outcomes.
For burns, is there a higher risk of getting another burn once you got the first one?
I haven't heard that. And in this paper, I think they were looking at more just general other issues. So not that I've heard. I mean, it does suggest, at least on those high utilizers, patients who are relatively higher risk to have kind of, you know, relative traumas, it showed that their relative rate was, you know, it does go down after the burn injury, but I don't know how long that sustains. It's still higher. They did actually there was a similar study from the same group that I didn't present, which just showed that the all-causes mortality for burn after burn injury remains higher than it does for the general population. Yeah. All right. Thank you.